And the grade is grade 7. And the topic that we'll be discussing today is going to be structure of matter and its properties. That is structure of matter and its properties. So basically, the topic is for grade 7s, but it's not limited to grade 7s. So I would advise those of you in grade 9 to also take note as the topic concerns you, because most of the ideas that will be discussed in this lesson are also connected to grade 9 as well, syllabus. So don't take it only as grade 7 lesson or topic, please. So all of you have to be serious in it and take notes. Take note of any new terms or concepts that you may come across and try to master them by going over your books at home and read over. So good. Now the topics that we are going to discuss under this theme here, matter and its structure, is what is matter. First, we'll have to learn about what is matter. We also will be looking at how do we measure matter. What are some of the ways we can measure matter? We'll also be looking at elements, which we call as the simplest form of matter. Elements, the simplest form of matter. Elements of the periodic table, per se. We'll also be looking at properties of matter, which include physical properties and chemical properties of matter. We'll as well discuss about density, which also is a physical property of matter, the calculations involving density, and so on. Then we also look at states of matter, which also is a physical property of matter. And then we'll also be looking at states of matter. Sorry. We'll also look at change of state of matter. Change of state of matter. We'll also look at properties of matter in terms of chemical properties. Now we go straight into the lesson, and we start by discussing about what is matter. I'm pretty much sure that almost now, by now, most of you are fully well acquainted with the term matter, because from primary school I know you have been learning about matter and other things about matter. So now it's not a new term to most of you, but still, through the lesson you may come across some new words, so it's important to take note of them, please. Good. So let's define matter now. What is matter? What is matter? According to the definition, the way scientists define matter is, matter is anything that has mass and takes up space. Matter is anything that has mass and takes up space. Good. So that is to say that everything that is matter must have mass. Anything that is matter must as well have volume, that is, takes up space. This takes up space here, I mean volume. Every matter must have volume. So this is why we say matter is anything that has mass and takes up space, from the definition, please. So take note of these two words here, or terms, mass and volume. So everything that is matter must have this. In other words, we say these are the properties of matter. Matter must have mass. Matter as well must take up space. Or it must have volume, please. So take note of these two important terms there. We mentioned everything around us is matter. Wait, do you believe that or not? Of course, I believe it, and I'm sure you must also believe. Everything around us, in our surrounding, can be classified as matter. Why do we say that? This is simply because every substance has mass. Every substance takes up space. Whether we touch the substance, we can touch it or cannot touch it. Whether we will be able to see it or we cannot see it. But so long it has mass, it takes up space or volume, it is matter. Most of the matter, we can touch them. Most of the matter, we can see them. But some of the matter, we cannot see them. Example is air. If we cannot see air, we cannot touch air, what is still classified as matter? What is the reason for that? It is simply because air have mass and air takes up space. So therefore it is classified as matter, please. So take note of those things. We said matter has different properties. Or characteristics. Matter have different or very different properties or characteristics. So each particular kind of matter have its own physical properties and chemical properties. We have different types of matter. So this is why matter is in fact divided into states that are called states, physical states, solid, liquid, and gas. The solids have their own properties, liquids have their properties, gases have their own properties, but as well, they are all matter, per se, please. Good. We see a term there, chemistry, and what is chemistry? We said chemistry is the study of these properties and how matter changes. As we just mentioned right now, we say every matter or matter has very different properties or characteristics. But which aspect of science deals with these properties or the study of these properties or characteristics? The aspect of science or branch of science that deals with the study of matter and its properties altogether is what is called chemistry. So we must not forget this, you have learned this already, the branches of science. And through there, you have learned what is chemistry. Where we said it's the study of the behavior of matter, how matter interact together to produce new substances with different properties. So all the properties and behavior of matter are studied in that branch called chemistry. So please take note of all these new terms or terms you may have seen here right now. Look around the classroom. Can you identify any example of matter? So I'll urge all of you while you are sitting and watching in your houses, look around your environment and look around and classify anything that you see around you, whether it is matter or not. I will want to believe anything you see around you there is all matter. So you have to understand that. Whether even the air around you in your house is matter. The tables in your house, the chairs, your beds, your clothes, the shoes, every other thing that is around you is all matter, please. How can all of this stuff be matter? Very important question there. How can all this stuff be matter? Every substance that is around you is matter. How can that be possible? Why? The simple reason is because every substance has mass, every substance takes up space, that we say has volume. So therefore, that's why every substance is matter. That's the reason, please. Okay? Where did all this come from as well? Or where did it come from? Matter actually itself. Where did it come from? Very important question as well. So you may brainstorm by yourself and think about that. Where does matter come from? Actually, matter comes from particles that we call atoms. Very small particles that cannot be seen by the naked eye. But they come together to form what we call as matter, please. So matter is made from what is called particles. Very small matter, units of matter, please, that are called particles. What are atoms? As we just mentioned right now, matter is made up of atoms. So what are these atoms? We say all matter is made up of small particles that are called atoms, please. So one can say atoms come together to make up matter. Atoms are the basic unit of an element. Atoms are the basic unit of an element. And what are elements in actual sense? Elements are thought of as the basic building blocks of matter. Just we mentioned right now, matter. This matter is made from elements. And the elements that make up matter actually are made up of atoms. So this is why basically we said matter is made from atoms. Because the elements that come together to make matter are actually themselves made up of atoms, very small particles. Elements are pure substances. Take note. Elements are pure substances that can be broken down any further without changing into something new. Please. You are looking at that word, they are pure substance. When a substance is pure, what do we mean? What is a pure substance? A pure substance is matter that has unique physical and chemical properties. A pure substance is matter that has unit's physical and chemical properties, such as melting point, boiling point, and freezing point. Good. When a substance is a pure substance, what will happen? That substance will have a fixed boiling point, will have a fixed melting point, will have a fixed freezing point. So by that you can identify a substance as a pure substance. Please. The makeup of atoms we discuss now. About atoms already, we say atoms are the smallest particles that make up of elements. But what make the atoms themselves? What make up these atoms? Make up of atoms. Atoms combine together to form elements. But the atoms themselves, do we ever ask ourselves, where do they come from? Or what make the atoms themselves? Atoms are made up of three parts, known as subatomic particles. Atoms are made up of three parts, known as subatomic particles. Each particle has a different charge. So now, this, in short, we say atoms are made up of smaller particles. Remember, the atom itself is very small. But the atom itself is made up of very small particles that we call as subatomic particles, particles that are smaller than the atom itself. And there are three. We'll come to learn about each of them as we move on through the lesson. So basically now, two of the particles are here with us, or we've seen them on the board. We have a proton, and a proton is positively charged, always. Positively charged. We have a neutron, and a neutron is positively charged. A neutron is neutral charge. Good. So atom is made up of particles called protons. The other one is called neutrons. The third one is called an electron. We'll come to that later, an electron. So these are basically the makeup of atoms, and we call them as subatomic particles. Subatomic particles. And each of these particles have a charge. A charge. The charge of a proton in an atom is what? Positive. That is positive. And the charge on the neutron is neutral. That means no charge. It has no charge. Not positive, not negative. The charge on the electron is what? Negative. Negatively charged. So basically, these are the subatomic particles, the particles that make up the atom, and the atom make up the element. But the particles that make the atom itself are called subatomic particles, and they are protons, neutrons, and electrons. And each of them have a charge. Don't forget the charges. The proton has a positive charge. The neutron is neutral. It's not positive, it's not negative. The electrons are negatively charged particles. And all of them together are called subatomic particles. Now the question is the big question. How do we get the first atoms? Matter is made from atoms. But where do these atoms themselves come from? How do we get atoms? All right, there's a big theory in front of us there that explains to us how atoms come into existence. It said there, when the Big Bang first happened, the universe was very hot. The Big Bang is a very big scientific theory. I'm not sure whether you have ever learned about that. What is the Big Bang? The Big Bang is a scientific theory that explains how the universe was formed millions of years ago, how the universe started. It's explained in a theory called the Big Bang. You may further go to investigate or research about Big Bang, if you wish, please. But it's a theory put forward by scientists that explains how the universe came into existence. According to that theory, the universe was a hot ball of gas, very, very hot indeed. And after a long time, because of the temperature, hotness, it exploded. And that explosion is what scientists call as the Big Bang. And the scientific belief is that the universe and the earth and everything in it come into existence after this Big Bang. All right, so when the Big Bang first happened, the universe was very hot. About, look at that big figure you are seeing there, 20 with series and series of zeros. What is that figure? It is 20 octillion. 20 octillion hotter than our sun at that time. So can you imagine that temperature? A temperature that is 20 octillion far more hotter than the sun. That's a very, very high temperature. That was how the universe was like before. And because of that high temperature, it cannot contain that anymore, so it has to explode. And scientists describe that explosion as what is called Big Bang. Okay. Then after a few minutes, after the Big Bang, after a few minutes, it cooled down to the point that protons and neutrons were able to be joined together. So you can see now how we started getting the first atoms on in the universe. It occurs after the Big Bang, after the big explosion. After a few minutes after the explosion, it cooled down to the point that what happened now, a particle called a proton and a particle called a neutron were formed after the cooling process was over, after the Big Bang. So this is how the atom started to be formed now. Because since you have the proton, you have the neutron, then that's the starting of the beginning of the atom. Now, only one particle is missing there. But later on, that particle also will join these things, and then we have three subatomic particles, protons, neutrons, and the other one, we'll come to that later, that is called electrons, but we have already mentioned it already. Please. Good. Still about how do we get the first atoms. So it said after the Big Bang, soon after the Big Bang, these particles captured objects called electrons. You see that point now. After the Big Bang, a few minutes later, the proton and the neutron were formed. But a little bit more later, this proton and neutron captured another particle or object. And that object or particle is what is called the electron. Why does that happen? Who can think about that? Why does that happen? Why were these particles able to attract the neutron? What happened actually there is, since we mentioned the proton as a positive charge and the electron as a negative charge, and the rule is opposite charges attract. Opposites attract. So the proton being positively charged, the electron being negatively charged, what will happen? They will attract each other. The positive and the negative charges will attract. So this as a whole now results in the formation of a full atom with the three particles, proton, neutron, and electron. So the atom now is completed with three subatomic particles. Good. This is because opposite charges are attracted to each other. That's the reason why the proton was able to attract the electron, as I just mentioned, because opposite or opposite charges attract each other. A positive and a negative will attract, but a negative and a negative will repel, or a positive and a positive will repel. Good. When this happened, the first two elements, and consequently, the first two atoms were formed. So shortly after the Big Bang, what happened? When the atoms were formed now, the atom is completed. A proton, neutron, and electron were all formed to form the atom. What happened? That results in the formation of the first two atoms, and consequently as well, the first two elements in the universe. And what are these first two atoms and elements that were formed in the universe? We'll learn that as we move on. opposites attract the same about the proton and the electron? Because you will need this information. Later, keep in mind this old phrase. Opposites attract. Opposites attract. Always. Remember that phrase, always. A positive and a negative will attract. That is why the proton was able to attract the electron to be able to form the first atoms in the universe. How are atoms arranged now? We already know now how the atom was formed. And atoms contain three basic particles that are called subatomic particles. We learned them already, proton, neutron, electron. But now, how are these particles arranged in the atom? That you have to understand very well now. The atomic structure, you have to understand that. We know that an atom is made of protons, neutrons, and electrons already. But how are these three particles arranged in the atom? So that diagram explains to you that very clearly there. It shows you the structure of the atom, the atomic structure. So you see there, the center of the atom is called the nucleus. Protons and neutrons are found there, in the nucleus of the atom. That's where you find the proton and the neutron. This is the conventional structure of an atom, spherical in shape. And in the center of the atom, we have a place or part there called nucleus. That's the center of the atom. And in this nucleus, there are two particles in this nucleus. We have a proton and the neutron. They are found in the nucleus of an atom. Now, what about the electrons? Are they also found in the nucleus? No, they have their own place, and that is called the cell. This is called a cell. You have the nucleus and the cell, and the electrons are always found on these cells, and they are not stationary at all. They are always moving around the nucleus, the electrons. So that's the second part you see there in red, there. Electrons move around the nucleus in the electron cell. The electron cell. So this is basically the structure of the atom. Try to always remember that. The atom is made up of a center called a nucleus. It has a center called a nucleus. And in the nucleus, you have the proton and the neutron. And it has a cell called electron cell. And in this electron cell, that's where you are able to find the electrons, please. So take note very well about the structure of the atom. Where are the protons and the neutrons located? In the nucleus of the atom. Where are the electrons located? On the electron cells of the atom. And they are always moving. They are not stationary. Please. Good. The first two elements, as we mentioned previously, the first two elements that were formed on the Earth, or in the universe in general, what were they? Now we have seen them already. In front, we have hydrogen and helium. These were the first two elements that were formed in the universe after the Big Bang. An element called hydrogen and an element called lithium. So that's what you are seeing there with the symbol H, hydrogen. The symbol HE is for helium. Now let's try to see a brief description about these two elements. Good. So hydrogen is the most common element. About 75% of the universe, hydrogen, the element hydrogen, is the most common element in the universe. It made up about 75% of our universe. That's hydrogen. Helium is the second most common element in the universe. It exists almost exclusively as a gas. Almost exclusively as a gas. So basically, these were the two first elements formed in the universe. So try to always remember that. It's a very important term or new idea for you. the first two elements that we have formed in the universe is hydrogen and helium. Hydrogen is the most common element, and it made up about 75% of the universe. It is made up of one proton and one electron, the element that is called hydrogen. If you look at its structure, hydrogen, the nucleus in the center there, it will have only a proton and one electron, hydrogen. Helium, as we already know, is the second most common element in the universe, and it exists exclusively as a gas always. It has two protons and one electron. Helium has two protons and one electron. In the nucleus of the helium atom, there are two protons there. But on the electron cell, there are only, It has as well also two electrons as well. Two protons, two electrons. Hydrogen, one proton, and one electron. The proton in the nucleus and the electron on the cell. Helium have two protons and also two electrons. The two protons are in the nucleus and the two electrons are on the orbital or the electron cell. Please, I don't want you to forget this anymore. The first two elements that were formed in the universe are hydrogen and helium. Please. So now let's look at the very simple questions here about what we have just learned a few minutes ago. It reads this way: which subatomic particle has a neutral charge? Which subatomic particle has a neutral charge? The answer should be B. The neutron has no charge. It is neutral. A proton has a charge and is positive. The electron has a charge and it is negative, but the neutron has no charge, therefore it is neutral. So to show you the answer, let me pull out so that shows us the correct answer there, B. Option B is the neutron, the subatomic particle that has a neutral charge or no charge at all is the neutron. So never forget that, please. Question 2. Which of the following subatomic particles are found in the nucleus of an atom? Which of the following subatomic particles are found in the nucleus of an atom? Option A, proton. Option B, neutron. Option C, electron. Can you guess the correct answers? So the correct answers here will include option A and option B. Option A and option B. By looking at the question, which says, which of the following subatomic particles are found in the nucleus of an atom? And we already learned about that now. We said the proton and the neutron are contained in the nucleus of an atom, but the electron is found on the electron cell. So therefore, basically now, the correct answer from this question should be A and B, option A and B. Now to be sure of our answer, let's see. Good. Option A and B are the correct answer here. The subatomic particles that are found in the nucleus of an atom are the protons and the neutrons. Please, so always remember that. Good. So basically, try and to remember all those points we discussed about the atom there. Now we move quickly to another aspect of the topic, which is how do we measure matter now? How can we be able to measure matter? We defined matter here and the properties of matter and other important things, what make up matter, the atoms and the elements. But now, as we already learned, everything in our this universe is matter. But what is matter? How do we measure matter now? Good. To measure matter now, we have to put some things into consideration. There are some basic quantities that we can use to measure matter. If you can remember in our definition, we say matter has what? Mass. Good. Matter takes up space. That is to say it has volume. So now if we basically, if we are to measure matter, what are we going to measure about matter? The only thing we can measure about matter is its mass and its volume. If there is anything else, maybe perhaps, its density. Its density so far. But for now, we are only going to base our discussion on mass and volume in a way to measure, or as ways to measure, matter. Later on, we'll come to discuss about density. So we start with mass now. As we see, mass. What is mass? What is mass? We define mass as this: the amount of matter or the amount of stuff in an object is called its mass. So mass is the amount of matter or amount of stuff in an object. That simply means to say the amount of particles contained in an object. The amount of particles that are contained in an object describe the mass of the object. Every substance must be made up of very small particles that are called atoms. So the particles in an object give it its mass. The more particles an object have, the more mass it will have. The lesser the particles, the lesser the mass. So we can measure mass of an object, please. Mass is measured in grams. In measuring mass, we use grams, which is G, or kilograms. Mass is also measured in kilograms, kg. So these are the units of mass, or units of measurement of mass. Gram, that is G symbol, kilogram, kg as the symbol, please. So basically, you may have other smaller units to measure mass, like the milligram. Okay, this is a very smaller unit. You have a bigger unit also to measure mass, which is the ton. So far, so all these also are units of mass. But the basic units are the grams or kilogram, please. And 1 kilogram will give you how many grams? What is 1 kilogram? 1 kilogram is equal to 1,000 gram. Please take that note. 1 kilogram is equal to 1,000 gram, please. Good. So as we already see, they are the prefix kilo. Anywhere you see the word kilo or prefix kilo, K-I-L-O, always referring to what? 1,000. 1,000. So if you say 1 kilogram, that is equal to 1,000, please. Grams. Okay? Good. Good. Another aspect of measurement of mass, which is weight and mass. Weight and mass. Weight and mass. What is weight? We already know what is mass. As the quantity of stuff or material or matter in an object, the amount of matter in an object is called the mass of the object. What about weight now? Because these are terms that we always hear as well. We hear people speaking about them. At times we ourselves say it. But what is weight? Good. Many times we use the words weight and mass interchangeably, or we use them to mean the same thing. That's quite often. Most of the time when we speak in our daily conversations, when we mention weight, we mean it as mass. When we mention mass, we interpret it as weight. But scientifically, that's not the way. That's not correct scientifically. In science, they have different meanings. All right? Mass and weight are not the same scientifically. All right. However, their definitions are not the same, even though in our daily conversations, we take mass as weight or weight as mass. But their definitions are totally different. And in the scientific sense, also, they are different. Let's look at the definition of weight now. What is weight of an object? What do we mean by the term weight? W-E-I-G-H-T, weight. We said weight is the measure of the force of gravity on an object. Weight is the measure of the force of gravity on an object. Take note of that definition very well. Weight is the measure of the force of gravity on an object. Weight is measured in pounds, as you see the symbol LBS, or newtons, symbol N. Good. So basically, when you talk about weight, weight is caused by a force. And that force is called force of gravity. It's the force that pulls objects to the center of the earth. Force of gravity, the force that pulls all objects to the center of the earth. So when the force of gravity pulls an object downwards to the earth, it gives it weight. Weight of an object is caused by the pull of the earth's gravitational force on it. So take that note also very well. What causes weight of an object? Weight of an object is caused by the pull of Earth's gravitational force on the object. Good. On Earth, all objects are attracted to the center of the Earth by the force of gravity. On Earth, all objects are attracted to the center of the Earth by a force called force of gravity. And it's this force of gravity that causes weight of an object. So therefore, weight also is a force in that sense, because it's caused by a force, and that force is the gravity acting on it. So therefore, because since we always measure force in Newton, force are always measured in Newton. That makes it sensible to measure weight also in Newton, because this weight is caused by a force. That is called gravitational force. Good. The force of gravity can be more or less on the moon or on other planets, depending on their sizes. Force of gravity is not the same everywhere. At some places it's more, other places it's less. But what caused that? The size of the objects, or the planets rather. Bigger planets have more what? More gravity. Smaller planets or objects will have less gravity. All right? So that's what we mean by that statement there. The force of gravity can be more or less on the moon or on other planets, depending on their sizes. So just to say that, if the planet is big enough or bigger, it will have more gravity. If the planet is small, it will have less gravity. So in that sense now, since we say gravity depends on the size, bigger planets have more gravity, force of gravity. Smaller planets have less gravity. So that's true that we can conclude that the weight of an object changes with its location, that is from planet to planet, or even from one part of the Earth's surface to another. Gravity is not the same, please. On the other hand, the amount of matter or stuff in an object does not change with the object's location. Remember here, you just mentioned, the weight of an object changes or varies with its location. That means weight changes from place to place in the universe. Why that? Because force of gravity is not the same everywhere in the universe. Force of gravity changes from one part of the universe to another, or from planet to planet. But mass now, look at this. The mass of the object will never change. It's constant everywhere in the universe. Whatever planet you are on, the mass will be the same for any particular object. It never changes. So that is one big difference between mass and weight. Take note of that. If we are to ask, give one difference between mass and weight. It's a very good idea you say this. Weight changes from place to place, or varies from place to place in the universe. But mass is constant. It doesn't change. It remains the same everywhere in the universe. So that's one big difference between mass and weight. The other difference are also there. We have most of you have those ideas already. Mass is measured in kilogram or grams, but weight is measured in newton or pounds. So take note of those differences. Mass is measured in kilogram or grams, but weight is measured in newton or pounds. And even the instruments we use to measure mass and weight are not the same. Mass is measured by using top pan balance or a chemical balance or a lever balance. But weight is only measured by using what you call a spring balance. So that's also a difference between mass and weight. We use a beam balance or lever balance or top pan balance to measure mass. But we only use a spring balance to measure weight of an object. So all these are good differences between mass of an object and weight. Please. Good. While your weight, that is the gravitational force on you, weight is the gravitational force on an object, may change if you travel to the moon. The mass, amount of stuff, the stuff there, I mean material, particles, amount of stuff in your body doesn't change. Let me repeat that part quickly. While your weight, that is your gravitational force that is acting on you, may change if you travel to the moon. If you leave the earth, go to the moon, your weight will change. The weight you have on the earth is going to be quite different on the weight you are going to have on the moon. If your weight on the earth, for example, is just 10 newton on earth. Now, as you travel from earth to the moon, what has happened? This weight is going to be far less than this. You can approximate it to be less than 2, in fact, around 1.6 newton on the moon. So that's the difference between mass and weight. Weight changes from place to place, but mass remains constant. Your weight on earth, when it's 10 newton, will change when you go to the moon. It's going to be less than 10, around just 1.6 newton on the moon. Why that? Because the earth is bigger than the, it's a bigger planet. That's why it has more gravitational force, therefore more weight. But the moon is a small, it's very small indeed, smaller than the earth, not very small though, but it's smaller than the earth. Therefore, the gravitational force on the moon is not going to be the same about the gravitational force on the earth. The earth will have more gravitational force than the moon. So because the earth have more gravitational force, more weight. Because the moon have less gravitational force, therefore less weight. Good, so those are some little illustrations there. As you see, 1 kilogram on earth, 1 kilogram on the moon. So 1 kilogram on the earth is going to be approximately 1 pound on earth. 1 kilogram on earth, in terms of newton, is just 1 pound. And 1 pound is just 10 newton. This is the earth. 1 kilogram on earth. So on earth, 1 kilogram will give you 1 pound. And this is just 10 newton. But now, on the moon, let me make it smaller than the earth. This is the moon now. 1 kilogram on the moon. But that's going to be just 1 over 6 pounds. Or 1.6 newton. So look at this here now. On earth, your mass is 1 kilogram. But you go to the moon, what happened? Does the mass change? No, it doesn't change. It remains the same. That explains to us the concept that mass is always constant. Anywhere you go in the universe, mass remains the same. If the mass is 1 kilogram on the earth, is still going to be the same 1 kilogram on the moon. But that 1 kilogram now on Earth, if you go to the moon, its weight on Earth is going to be 10 newton. But the moment it leaves the Earth to the moon, that 10 newton weight will change now. Instead, it's going to be 1.6 newton. So therefore, we have more weight on the Earth and less weight on the moon. Why do this happen again? Because the Earth is a bigger planet than the moon. What does that make it to have more gravity? The Earth has more gravity, but the moon has less gravity. Less gravity will give you less weight. More gravity will give you more weight. I hope you are able to understand this illustration here very well. Please. Mass remains constant everywhere on any planet, but weight changes. Please. Weight on Earth, 10 newton, is not going to remain as 10 newton on the moon. Instead, 1.6. But 1 kilogram on the Earth is the same 1 kilogram on the moon, and any other planet you go, still 1 kilogram. Or 1 kilogram, please. So, from mass and weight, or mass, let's look at another aspect of matter, which is volume. We will be doing the calculations later on now. We are only discussing about the concepts, the terms, the meanings, and so on. Later on, we'll deal with the calculations, how to calculate mass, how to calculate weight, likewise volume. Good. So let's look at volume now, quickly. Remember, we know mass now. Mass is the amount of stuff or matter in an object. We know weight. Weight is the force of gravity acting on an object. Let's try to know what is volume now. What is volume? What is volume? The amount of space that matter occupies is called its volume. Amount of space occupied by an object is called the volume of the object. The amount of space occupied by an object is called the volume of the object. Every substance must have also volume, as we discussed already. Matter is anything that has mass and occupies space. So anything that is matter must occupy space, must have volume. Take note. All right. Good. So how do we measure volume now? Volume is measured in milliliters. Remember, we know the unit of mass now. Mass, the units are what? Gram, kilogram. Remember that always, please. So what about volume now? In measuring volume, we use what is called milliliters. Milliliters, the symbol ML. Or still, we use what is called cubic centimeters, which is symbol CM, 3, cube. The superscript, there, the 3 is a cube, please. So these are the basic units of volume. We measure volume in milliliters and also in cubic centimeters. But still, there are other units of volume as well. For bigger units, you may use meter cube, which is called meter, or cubic meter. You may use cubic meter, a bigger volume, and which is abbreviated as M cube. Please, so take note of that, please. So most often, the volume of liquids are measured in milliliters or liters. And the milliliter is the smallest unit of liter. So that mostly deals with liquids. For volume of solids, especially very light solids, we use cubic meter or cubic centimeter, please. But cubic centimeter can also be used to measure liquid as well. But generally now, these are the units of volume, whether it deals about liquids or solids. But the general for a unit of volume is liters, and the smaller unit is milliliter or cubic centimeters, and the bigger unit for cubic centimeter is the cubic meter, or cubic meter in abbreviation. So take note, please. Good. So that's just a demonstration of some instruments there and some objects. That's the measuring cylinder. That's a tube or a box somehow showing the volume. So listeners and viewers, we'll draw the curtain here for today, for this lesson. But the topic or the lesson is not finished. But any time I come back and meet you, we'll continue from where we stop. So for today, thank God. Thank you very well for your kind attention.